Welcome, my friends! In this video, we will be discussing how to construct a one-sample confidence interval for the parameter p in the binomial distribution, often called the population proportion. I would advise watching my video on the binomial distribution if you aren't familiar with it before watching this one. Recall that in the binomial distribution, there are two outcomes, success and failure, where x represents the number of successes in n trials, and p represents the probability of success on each trial. For example, about 65% of Americans believe in intelligent life on other planets. Suppose that 100 Americans were surveyed and asked if they believe in intelligent life on other planets. X represents the number of individuals from the survey who believe in intelligent life on other planets, and follows a binomial distribution with a sample size of n equals 100 and a probability of success of p equals 0.65. We could then answer questions like, what is the probability less than 50 people from a survey of 100 believe in intelligent life on other planets? Or what is the probability between 60 and 80 people from a survey of 100 believe in life on other planets? Oftentimes, p is unknown and needs to be estimated. The statistic p hat or p prime is a point estimate for the parameter p. Either notation is fine, but p hat is more common, so that's what I'll be using in my videos. P hat is equal to the number of successes x divided by n, the number of trials, or the sample size. P hat is the value that we will build our confidence interval around to estimate p. Before I show you the formula for the confidence interval, I want to do a little bit of a proof so that you understand what the confidence interval is doing. Recall that if x is the number of successes in n trials, then x follows a binomial distribution. The mean of the binomial distribution, you might remember, is n times p, and the standard deviation is the square root of n times p times q. Q is just the probability of failure, and is the complement of p, so it's 1 minus p. Now, instead of being interested in x, the number of successes, we are interested in p, the proportion of successes in n trials, which is just x divided by n. So we have a transformation of the variable x. Now we have x divided by n instead of just x. This changes the mean and the standard deviation. The mean of p is just the mean of x divided by n, which is literally just the mean of x divided by n. I'm using the notation mu with parentheses to represent the mean of some value, and not to represent multiplication. We already know that the mean of x is just n times p, so we have n times p divided by n. N times p divided by n cancels the n's, and we get just p, exactly what we want. Now, the standard deviation of x is the square root of n times p times q. Again, I'm using sigma parentheses to represent the standard deviation of some value and not multiplication. So the standard deviation of p is the standard deviation of x divided by n, which is just the square root of n times p times q divided by n. Through a few steps, we find that the standard deviation of p is the square root of pq divided by n. This is a very important quantity, and will show up many times throughout the formulas we will be using relating to proportions. Remember that the standard deviation of the proportion p is the square root of pq divided by n. Alright, now we are ready to introduce the formula for the one sample confidence interval of the population proportion p. The formula is p hat plus or minus z times the square root of p hat times q hat divided by n. P hat is the sample proportion and is calculated by taking x and dividing by n. X is the number of successes in our sample, and n is the sample size. Z is the positive z-score corresponding to our level of confidence. Q hat is just 1 minus p hat. There are a few things to notice about this confidence interval. First, notice that we are using the standard normal z distribution. This is allowable as long as n times p hat and n times q hat are both at least equal to 5. Some textbooks say that they should even be at least equal to 10. This is similar to the requirement that n be greater than or equal to 30 in the one sample mean confidence intervals. Technically, we should have n times p and n times q both at least 5. But of course, we don't know what p and q are, so we'll have to do the sample estimates of p hat and q hat. Also notice that the z-score is multiplied by the standard deviation of p, which we derived in the previous slide, except we have p hat and q hat in the formula instead of just p and q. The reason we use the sample estimates, p hat and q hat, here is because we don't know p and q. Remember, the whole point is to create a confidence interval for P. So the best thing we can do is to substitute the point estimates for P and Q, which are just P hat and Q hat. This is very similar to how we substituted S for sigma in the one sample T interval for population means. Let's look at an example. A group of students at Grand Rapids Community College were asked if they believe in intelligent life on other planets. Of the 100 students surveyed, 60 stated that they believe in extraterrestrial life. Create a 99% confidence interval for the proportion of GRCC students who believe in life on other planets. Now the first thing to do is to write out some of the information. 100 students were surveyed, so the sample size n is 100. The 60 that believe in extraterrestrial life is x, the number of successes. The sample proportion, p hat, is just x divided by n, and is equal to 60 divided by 100, or 0.6. The confidence level is 99%. We need to check if n times p hat and n times q hat are both at least 5. Remember that q hat is just 1 minus p hat. 1 minus 0.6 is 0.4. 100 times 0.6 is 60, and 100 times 0.4 is 40. Both values are at least 5, so the central limit theorem ensures that we can use the normal distribution to approximate the distribution of p hat. Now, as for any confidence interval, we should also be assuming that there was a random sample. And as I've stated in other videos, we can imply that that's the case in most circumstances, even if it isn't explicitly stated. Alright, here is the formula for the one sample proportion confidence interval. The picture centers p hat in the middle with 99% or 0.99 of the probability in the center, and 1% split into the two tails, or 0.005 in each tail, so that the total probability sums to 1. The lower and upper bounds of the confidence interval go at the boundaries of the shaded area. The z-score that we need for the formula corresponds to the positive z-score at the upper bound. I provided this table for common z-scores in a previous video, and for our 99% confidence interval, the z-score we need is about 2.576. If you want to know how to find this value using a table or a calculator, then check out one of the videos in the description. Plugging into the formula, we have 0.6 plus or minus 2.576 times the square root of 0.6 times 0.4 divided by 100, which becomes two different terms, one for the addition part of the plus or minus sign and one for the subtraction part. We get 0.7262 when we add and 0.4738 when we subtract. These are the upper and lower bounds of our confidence interval. Since the formula is a tiny bit more involved, I figured I'd show you how to type it in into the calculator. I have a TI-84 calculator here, but any scientific calculator should work similarly. Type 0.6 plus 2.576 times the square root of 0.6 times 0.4 divided by 100. After that, you might have to close the parentheses on some calculators. If we press enter, we get the upper bound of the confidence interval. The lower bound is just the same thing, but the plus sign needs to change to a minus sign. On this calculator, I can press second and then enter, which brings up my previous calculation. And then I can scroll back through to the left and change this plus sign to a minus sign. And when I press enter, we get the lower bound. Okay, all we have left is the conclusion. We are 99% confident that the interval between 47.38% and 72.62% contains the population proportion of Grand Rapids Community College students who believe in extraterrestrial life. I like to state my proportion conclusions in percentages, as they typically make more sense to the general public. And we are done! Alright, my friends, we have finished our discussion of one sample proportion confidence intervals. We will be exploring many more fun and exciting statistical topics that you won't want to miss, so make sure to check out our other videos.